Welcome to the class. Today we'll see the second module of your syllabus, and that too the first chapter of second module of your syllabus of Introduction to Information Security or Introduction to Cyber Security. This first module basically is based on security management practices. Sorry, this second module which is based on the management practices so far as information security is concerned, and the first chapter is the security management practices. So, security management, as the name. Before that, let us see what all things which we will be going to study in this first chapter. The first chapter basically it starts with overview of security management. Then the information classification process is there. Then we move on to learn the security policy. What exactly is the security? Is the meaning of security policy? Who decides that policy? Then we move on further with risk management. Then security procedures and guidelines. Then we go ahead to learn the BCP and DR techniques, and then finally ethics and best practices. So at the end of the lecture, you should be aware of all these seven points. Let's begin with the first point, and that is nothing but the overview of security management. Security management, as the word says, it involves two things. First is the security, which more or less means the protection, and management, it is the job of top level of the people in your organizational hierarchy, in which they decide, means planning, decision making, then organizing. These all are the functions of the management. So in information security management, what you actually try to do is you try to devise some, you know, management policies in order to strengthen your protection of your information. Fine. So the definition of security management is, security management is the identification of organization's assets, followed by development, documentation and implementation of policies and procedures in order to protect those assets. So this is what security management means. And this asset in information security is nothing but the information. So information is an important asset to the organization. So in short, you can say that in information security management, what is done is you identify the assets first. Those assets are nothing but the information assets, and you prepare some policy in order to protect those assets. You have to protect those assets from wide variety of threats. Okay. And then once the policy is prepared, you can implement that policy. It means that you need to see that whatever policy is documented or whatever policy has been written over there, that policy is being enforced throughout your organizational structure. And again, remember that this is not a fix and forget kind of thing. It is a continuous process. So you should keep on, the security professionals, they should keep on improving your security policy. Clear? So I hope this meaning of security management is clear to you. Now, whenever you want to, you know, strengthen the security of your organization, you must know where to begin from or what to start with. Clear? So if you want to analyze the, you know, if you want to develop some security plan to protect your information in your organization, then you can basically design any working security plan first, or you can validate if there is already some security measures or some security procedures are already being followed, then you can validate those security procedures. Okay. Or you can adopt some framework. Clear? So once the framework is there, then you can implement some management model in order to execute and maintain that plan. So whatever working security plan you are designing, you can you know, have some management model, some way in order to implement that plan. Okay. So the framework gets ready. After the framework, you can design some security blueprint of your security plan. That security blueprint is nothing but very detailed or the minute level or micro level of operations are described in that security blueprint. It describes complete security procedures which are adopted in your organization. And finally, there are the controls. Controls are nothing but the security measures or what various kind of security mechanisms that you are implementing in order to protect your assets. Clear? So framework, security blueprint and controls, these three are the important things in order to create one secure environment. Okay, and you can create the secure environment, or just to begin with, you can create some working security plan and you go on improving that plan. You can analyze that plan and you can keep on improving that plan. Fine. So, the next thing to study is the information classification. See, every organization has huge data, and information is extracted from this data. With digitization, the data explosion is bound to happen, or it is already happening in the organization. Clear? So, there are, you know, huge amount of data is there, then there is huge amount of information available at the discretion of the management today. Okay. So, but a very important thing to know over here is that all the information which are available in the management is not of the same kind. Clear? The information is of different kind. At the same time, it has different value also. It means that some information can be very, very important for the organization. Some information can be just important, or some can be useless information for the organization. Clear? But you need to classify this information in order to protect it, because according to the importance of the information, you need to have some security mechanism to protect that information. Clear? Forget about the organization. Let us take a simple example of your personal data. You all must be clicking pictures. Okay. So, those pictures or photographs, they can be of wide variety. So, you can share few photographs with your friends, you can share few, you don't mind making few photographs public on your Facebook wall or you know, anywhere. Clear? Or you may say that few of the photographs you don't want to share with anyone. Clear? So, accordingly, in the same way, the information is also of different kind. Some information needs very high level of protection, some needs moderate level of protection, or some information is there which organization itself wants to make public. Clear? So, you need to, you know, you need to understand this concept, and then you need, you should be able to evaluate this information on the basis of very important factors. Those are nothing but the CIA. That CIA of security, that CIA triad of the security is nothing but confidentiality, integrity and availability. So, in light of these three factors, you need to evaluate the information. Okay. So, and accordingly, the required protection level to secure the information is devised. Okay. So, according to the importance of the information, you need to have the, you need to decide what level of security or what level of protection is required to required for different classes of the information. Clear? So, the protection level determines the procedures. So, whatever protection level you are adopting, so that protection level is going to decide what are the procedures in order to handle that information, because the information you need, handling of information is nothing but storing of the information, passing of information from one end to another end, or processing of that information. Clear? And in order to have, you know, simplicity in handling that information, you need to label that information accordingly. So, you need to classify the information, and then you should also label that information according to your classification. Fine. So, classification of components must be specific to allow determination of priority levels. So, this classification of information should be pretty much, you know, pretty much strict or simple to understand. So, no ambiguity or clarity should be there. Okay. So, you cannot say that this information can be top secret information or it can be secret information. No. There should be distinct line of differences that in which class you need to put this information. Fine. So, categories must be comprehensive and mutually exclusive. So, whatever categories you are making, so this categorization can be customized, purely customized. Okay. So, according to your need, you can classify the information, and as per the classification of the information, you can decide the protection level of the information, or you can devise the mechanism or the policy in order to protect that information. Clear? So, information classification, as I mentioned, that you can develop your criteria based on many questions. So, you can keep on questioning yourself so far as deciding the category of information is concerned. Okay. So, you can ask the questions like, which information is most critical to organization success? okay? Or you can say, you can ask the question that which information generates high amount of revenues or high amount of profits to the organization, or you can say that which information would be most expensive to replace or protect, okay? Or there are, you know, there are n number of questions. There are many questions which you can, you know, keep on asking yourself, and the more questions you questions you keep on asking, the better will be your criteria in order to classify that information. Fine. So there can be some information which cannot be reconstructed again. Your photographs, your memories, the memories of your childhood, you cannot reconstruct that. Okay. So similarly, in organizations also, there are there is some kind of information which the organization cannot, you know, generate again. Okay. So accordingly, you can classify the information in various categories. Those categories can be top secret, secret, confidential, sensitive, unclassified, or unclassified information. Fine. So this can be one category, or there can be another category that is confidential, private, sensitive, and public information. Now, although these are just the examples of the categories, but you can devise your own customized way of categorizing this information or classifying this information. Okay? And why you are classifying this information? Because on the basis of this classification, you are going to decide the importance level of the information, and on the basis of importance of the information, sorry, you are going to protect the you are going to decide what is the protection level of that information. Fine. So one more important thing to study so far as security management is concerned is the security policy, right? Because security management is nothing but devising of the policy. Okay. So this security policy, basically it is the broad broad statements basically which are made by the top level of management. Okay. Those are not the specific things. Rather, there is broad explanation of what needs to be done. Clear? And this security policy basically it should reflect the goals of the goals of the organization. Okay. So whatever goals are decided by the top level of management, those goals are reflected in the security policy also. Okay. So a good security policy, basically it addresses constraints on its assets. So whatever constraints are there on the asset itself, so that should be addressed properly. Then what are the constraints which are imposed on the adversaries? So if there are there are adversaries, of course, so you should understand that what are the various constraints which are imposed on the adversaries. Or you should also, the security policy should also address the constraints which are there on the functions, flows, or the procedures, or the external access. The means all the constraints on all these factors should be addressed properly by your security policy. Okay. Then drafting and enforcement, those two are the different things, and both the things are very, very, very important, right? So you should, if whenever you prepare the security policy, it should be properly documented, okay? And again, it is also job of the management to see that whatever things are documented, those things are getting enforced also, okay? So the implementation of policy is also equally important, and this implementation is actually done with the help of sub policy or the functional policies. Okay. So the security policy is broad one. Okay. The functional policies, they will address specific issues. Okay. It can be policy for having internet access. Okay. So internet access policy, that can be one thing, or the policy to create one user. Okay. So user creation policy. So all those policies, those are the sub policies. Clear? And those various functional policies are actually prepared in order to achieve what is described in your overall security policy. So let us have a quick overview what we have studied until now. We started with the overview of security management, then we have learned how to classify the information, and again we have seen some, some introduction to your security policy. Okay, what is good security policy, that we have seen. Okay, now let us move on and go to risk management. Okay, risk, as you are, most of you must be knowing that risk is nothing but likelihood that something bad is going to happen. Okay, so risk management is it involves more or less the identification, evaluation and mitigation of the risk to an organization or to the asset. Okay, so three important things: identification, evaluation and mitigation of the risk. Okay, we never say that the risk is zero. Okay, rather we a good security professional will always try to mitigate the risk. Okay, and in order to have a good security management good security management through the risk management policy, one must have thorough knowledge of inside environment and the outside environment along with the technology. Okay, so that is required. A good security professional will always have complete will always study complete environment, your the internal environment and the external environment also, because there are threats in internal environment and external environment also. Okay, and threat is nothing but something which has potential to damage you. Okay, and likelihood of that threat is nothing but risk. Clear? So in risk management, thorough knowledge or everything is studied, and accordingly your policy is decided. Clear? So risk management, it involves so many things. The first thing is the identification of assets and their evaluation, okay, which we already done in our information classification process. Okay, so asset identification and their valuation means whether the asset is very important or whether it is, you know, just important or it is less important. That is also one must know that. Okay, then you assess the threat. Okay, so you know what to protect your assets. Okay, then you know you want to protect it against what? Against nothing but the threat. Okay, then vulnerability assessment is there. Vulnerability assessment is nothing. Vulnerability, you must have studied it in your first model. Vulnerability is nothing but weakness or flaw in the system. Okay, so vulnerability assessment, in vulnerability assessment, all the flaws or the possible entry points for the hackers, basically. Okay, so weaknesses are studied. Okay, you need to evaluate your policies and the procedures in while assessing your vulnerability. Okay, and after that, in risk management, the next thing which comes up is the calculate impact of threat on each of the assets. Okay, and this asset is done and the analysis of this impact of threat on each of the asset is done quantitatively and qualitatively also. Okay, it means that, see, you have there is hardly a situation that you have only, you know, few assets to protect. Mostly, you know, big organization, in a complex organization, there are too many assets. Okay, and the threats are also many. So you should map each of the threat against each of the asset against each of the threats. Okay, then only you can get a clear picture that what threat is likely to exploit which asset. Clear? So analysis is very, very important part in risk management, and there are various quantitative and qualitative techniques which are there in order to analyze your impact of the threat. Okay, then accordingly you can adopt some appropriate control measure. Okay, control measure is nothing but something which you are going to, you know, put in place in order to block that threat. Okay, or in order to mitigate the risk which will be associated with that threat. Okay, so that is nothing but the control measures. And then finally, you can evaluate effectiveness of this measure. So whatever security measures you are implementing, then the effectiveness of this security measures are is measured basically in the risk management. And that is how you manage your risk. So these are the important steps so far as risk management is concerned. So once at the end of it, you can decide that whether you want to whether the risk can be removed, okay, or whether you can mitigate the risk, or whether you can transfer that risk, or whether you should accept that risk. Okay, these are various, you know, the meaning of this removal, mitigation, transfer and acceptance is pretty much different. In risk management, you can remove the risk by applying some safeguards. It means that if you feel that my asset is prone to some security attacks if I put it on for online use. Clear? So you can reduce, you can simply remove that risk by blocking access to that asset from the internet. Clear? So that is removal of the risk. Okay? Then you can mitigate the risk. It means that you can reduce the impact which that threat can cause to your asset. So the damage can be reduced. Okay? The impact of that threat to your asset can be reduced in mitigation of the risk. Okay? Or you can outsource it. Okay? That is nothing but transfer of the risk. A simple example, if you have important data, if you want to protect it, and if protection of you are not into the core business of protection of the data. Let us see, if you are into automobile manufacturing, or if you are into mobile service providing, if you are provider of a mobile service, then it means that information security is not your core business. So you can simply outsource it to some IT company, that this is my data and it is your job to protect this data. If you are unable to protect this data, then you are bound to pay me some compensation. Okay? So they can sign some SLA, service level agreement, and accordingly the risk can be transferred, okay, to some third party. Or the final thing is that you can accept that risk. It means that you can understand that this is something which may cause me some damage, but still it is fine. Okay? I can accept it, I can bear, I can tolerate that damage, that is why I am accepting it. Because in certain cases you may feel that the cost benefit analysis plays important role here. Okay? It means you may see you may feel that there is huge amount of money which are needed in order to protect some information, okay, and this money required to protect this information is far more than the damage which may the damage that the company may have to face if that information is compromised. Clear? So in that case, cost benefit analysis is done, and accordingly it is decided whether you want to mitigate the risk, whether you want to transfer the risk, or whether you want to accept that risk. Okay? And it is very, very important thing for the management, because in businesses everything revolves around money making. Clear? So based on the value of the asset and cost of implementing security measures, you have to make the call. The top management has to decide. It has to do some decision making based on these factors. Okay? Then we have seen the procedure. We have seen the policy. What is the security policy? Okay? Then we have also seen the risk management. How risk management is done? Then next thing to study is nothing but the procedures. Okay? Procedures and policies, they are very different. Policies, they are the broad level terms. Okay? The broad level statements of the management. Okay? And the procedures is nothing but procedures are the detailed step to perform specific task. Okay? If you want to if you want to delete one user account from your active directory, or let us say there is one employee and the management has fired that employee. Okay? So if you are terminating the services of that employee today, then how account of that employee should be blocked instantly, right? So that is the part of the procedure. So whether the management is going to inform to HR, okay, the HR people, the human resource management people, okay, or whether the human HR people or HR manager is going to inform the IT cell or the IT section of your company, okay? So who is going to inform IT people of your company to delete or block the block account of that user, okay, the employee which is being terminated right now, okay? Because after termination, if his account is still available with him, then he can cause some damage to your information. Clear? So procedures, that those are the detailed steps to perform a specific task, and those procedures are required in order to achieve whatever things are there in the policy, or whatever things are described there in the policy. Fine. So I hope the difference between policies and procedures is clear to you. Then there is one more term which information security people anyone who is using technology, okay, they keep on coming across is the guidelines. Okay, guidelines, they are different than the procedures. Guidelines are basically the recommended methods, okay, the recommended methods. They are not the mandatory, okay, they are not the mandatory or compulsory things which you should do. Okay, a simple example is the backup of your data. It is recommended that you take daily backup of your data, or it is recommended that you scan your PC for viruses once in a day. Okay, so those are the recommendations. Okay, and those recommendations form the part of the guidelines. Okay, so guidelines are recommended but not the required things. Clear? Then the next thing which is there in the syllabus is the business continuity planning or disaster recovery planning. Okay, and BCP, in short, it is called BCPDR, and it is very, very important thing in today's businesses which operates more on a technology, right? See, take a simple example. Gone are the days when you go to the bank, then you deposit some money. Okay, so when you deposit the money, the clerk, the cashier over there, he used to make some entries in the ledger. Okay, and those ledgers are were used to kept in the bank only. Okay, this thing used to happen previously. Okay, these days what is done, you simply go to the bank, you deposit the cash, okay, and you get the SMS that so and so amount has been credited to your account. Okay, so the entries are in digitized form. It means that whatever data is there with the bank must be storing that data somewhere. Okay, so tomorrow if there is a fire, if fire breaks out in the data center, okay, then that their data will be lost. Clear? So the details of your accounts will be lost. So it will be very difficult for the bank to run the business, because if one customer's amount is 1 lakh rupees in his account, he may claim that I was having 10 lakh rupees in my account. Clear? So that is why business continuity planning or disaster recovery planning has come up. Okay, wherein the critical business units must be operational during any disruption. Okay, so in BCP what is seen is that whatever critical business units are there, they should be operational. Okay, or even if they go offline for a while, then what is the minimum period of time within which all the business units should keep will be up and operational. Okay, how to protect that data. Okay, so this BCPDR plan, it basically answers the question that what first steps to follow. So in case of eventuality, what are the first steps to follow? If there is a fire breakout in the data center, should I take a bucket of water and throw it on my computer, or throw it on the servers? Okay, so that is decided by the BCP. Okay, then how to recover what to recover first? So if you have to recover your data, then what to recover first? Okay, that is also important to decide. Clear? Then again, how fast should it be recovered? What is the minimum time within which it should be recovered? Okay, so RTO is one of the important concepts so far as BCPDR is concerned. Okay, recovery time objective it is called. Then what all should be recovered? So that is called disaster recovery plan basically. Okay, so what data should be recovered? Okay, that is described in DRP. Then very, very important thing is where to work from, because if the building is already a fire has been, if there is a breakout of a fire in the building, then where will I be working from? That is also one of the important thing to decide. Very, very minute thing, but that is very important thing to decide, and that should be clearly mentioned in BCPDR plan. Okay, and then the other things are how long can I go with it. So whatever ad hoc arrangements you are doing in the time of eventuality, so how long should you keep on working on with that ad hoc or temporary arrangement? Okay, and how and when to test my plan, because testing of the plan is also important thing. Okay, so how that mock drill can be how can you make that mock drill in order to decide whether the plan is working fine or not. So that is decided in BCPDR. Then the next thing, that is the ethics. Ethics basically, few of you or the people from the philosophy background, they must be knowing what exactly ethics means. Ethics, they are the branch of philosophy which will decide, which is more involved in systemizing or, you know, in defending what is the wrong, the concept, what is right and what is wrong. Okay, so you need to means what is the wrong behavior and what is right behavior, that is decided by ethics, and it is more related to philosophy. Okay, so ethics, it means the standards of right and wrong behavior. Okay, or it can be considered as a gauge of personal integrity. Okay, or it is the basis of trust in relationships. Fine. See, a simple example. If you are the person who is looking after systems and network of your organization, okay, or if you are the one who is, you know, maintaining some application, okay, some email application, okay, so it may be the case that you come to know about the password of your users, okay. So even though you know the password, then it is your moral responsibility not to disclose those passwords to anyone, or not to misuse that those passwords, okay. Or the second example, suppose you have some data. If you are into HR, okay, then your company is having employees of, let us say, 2000. Your company is a huge company, okay, having the employee of 2000 employees or 2000-3000 employees, okay. If you have the access to database of those many employees, then you cannot sell that database, okay. You cannot copy that database and sell it to some marketing firm, okay. So that is the ethics, clear. So there are standards of conduct as they pertain to the use of information systems. So far as ethics in information systems are concerned, those are the standards of conduct, okay. Because see, law is not going to be sufficient everywhere, okay. So ethics has to be in place, because sometimes in the book of law, you may say that you are not committed any offense, but so on the moral or ethical background, your behavior might be wrong or your action might be wrong, okay. So that is the meaning of ethics, and that is also that shows the importance of the ethics, because the environment is changing very fast, okay, and the legal system is not going to, you know, make the dynamic changes in itself, in the laws and acts, okay, in order to address those changes, okay. So that is why the new branch has come up. Actually, it is the old branch, but its importance has been highlighted in the information systems these days, okay. So ethics are the guidelines of morally acceptable use of computers, okay. So if you are using computer system, it should be used in a morally acceptable way, okay. So there are various factors which are associated with ethical issues. Those factors are nothing but the information ownership, the person who owns the information, okay. If there is company database, that then who should be given ownership of that database, that is important thing. Then authenticity of the information, if some information is getting generated, then there should be proper authenticity has to be there, okay. Then accessibility of the information or the user privacy, those are another few factors which are associated with the ethical issues, okay. Then apart from ethics, there are standards also, okay. Standards, you must have heard that Hallmark, okay, or there are so many standards in, available in the market. Hallmark is one thing, then ISI, then EGMARK, okay. Those are the standards, and standards basically they increase your, you know, trust in that product basically, okay. Or you can say that yes, this product is genuine if it has some, you know, marking stamped on it, okay. So in information systems also there are various standards, because it is hard for a legal system to change in order to cope up with the dynamically changing technology, okay. So just to cope up with that, apart from ethics, there are standards also, okay. So just to cope up with the dynamic changes, there are standards also. So if your organization has to has to get certified with some standards, then there are some standards are nothing but some controls or some rule set is there, and it is job of your organization to to comply with those standards or to comply with those controls. Okay, so once you are complying with those controls which are mentioned in any standards, then you are certified with the standards. Okay, so standards and guidelines are important in computer security. Few standards which are used in computer security or information security apart from ISO. Okay, there are HIPAA or FERPA. Okay, those standards, those are in use for a long time. Okay, or cybercrime treaty is also another example of regulatory standards. If you want to know more about these standards, you can Google them. Okay, but I hope the meaning of the regulatory standards is clear to you. Okay, so standards are there, and if your organization wants to go for that standardization, they should comply with the controls or the with the procedures which are mentioned in that, or with the rules which are mentioned in those standards. Clear. So with this, I would like to finish this lecture. Just a brief recap: what we have learned, we have seen the overview of security management. We have seen what exactly security management means. Okay, what is the meaning of that security management? Then we have seen the classification of information, how you can classify the information. Okay, there are various criteria which you can use for classification of the information, and this criteria, it can be age of the information or the useful life of the information. Okay, means how old is the information, or you can your personal association with that information, or the value of the information. Okay, based on that you can classify the information. Then we have seen the security policy. Okay, what is the security policy and how good what constraints security policy is should address. Okay, then we have seen the risk management, how the risk is managed, the complete procedure, step by step procedure of managing the risk. Then we have seen the procedures and guidelines, security procedures and guidelines. What does it mean? What means the procedures and what means the guidelines? Okay. Then we have also touched upon introduced ourselves to the concept of business continuity and disaster recovery. Okay. And finally, we ended this lecture with ethics and the best practices and the standards. Okay. So thank you so much. If you have any questions, you can send your questions to the email address, that is ankush@unipune.ac.in. Okay, thank you so much.